Namaste to everybody. This prayer is from the Bhagavata Mahapuranam. It's on page 94 of this book, Universal Prayers. On the top of page 94, from Bhagavata Puranam, let me chant and then read the translation. Om Stvasyastu Vishvasya Kala Prasidatam Jayantu Bhutani Shivam Mithodhiya Manascha Bhadram Bhajata Dadokshaja Aveshatam No Matirapya Haituki Om Shanti 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 Om. May the world be peaceful. May the wicked become gentle. May all creatures think of mutual welfare. May their minds be occupied with what is auspicious. And may our hearts be immersed in selfless love for the Lord. Om peace. May there be peace and joy in our hearts. May there be peace and harmony amongst all beings. And may there be peace everywhere in nature. This prayer is particularly important in the present context, in the condition, situation in which we are going through in the whole world. It's very important that the wicked become gentle, all creatures think of mutual welfare, and may our minds be occupied with what is auspicious, and may our hearts be immersed in selfless love for the Lord. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. So let us now continue from where we left off last week. That is verse number 7 in chapter 7. 7-7. Very important verse. And it has practical implication in our daily lives. We'll examine that. So we did this last time, but I'll quickly go over it again. Verse number 7 in chapter 7. Matta parataram nanyat kinchidasti dhananjaya mai sarvamidam protam sutre manigana iva. Nothing whatsoever is beyond me. All this is strung on me like clusters of gems on a thread. Sutra means a thread. Manigana means a lot of beads used in making a necklace. There is one thread going through a large number of beads. What Bhagavan is saying is, he is the thread common, present in all of us. Each one of us is a mani. Each one of us is a bead. They're all different shapes, sizes, and colors, and names and forms. But every one of us is connected to everyone else through a common thread, that is the divine presence in all. One divinity present in all. Now, if you ask, how does it affect my daily life? It is a very important shloka. The idea that one divinity present in all beings. This will come again and again in the throughout the Gita. Whoever other person whom we come across, though he is different from me at the physical level, the innermost center core of his personality is same as mine. Whatever is the core of his personality, the divine presence within him or her, or it, inanimate objects, animal, plants too, is same as what is present in me. That one thing is common. That means, though physically at the physical level, we are all separate, different beings, different in every way. We think differently, we do things differently, our tastes are different, everything is different. But if you go deeper into our personality, we all converge into one divine presence. At the spiritual level, we are one. At the material, physical level, we are many. This is illustrated by the example of a tree, which will come in the 15th chapter. The example of a tree being one at one level and many at a different level comes in the Mahabharata, in the Ekata Upanishad, in the Gita. It's a very nice imagery. If you imagine a big tree, if you look at it from the top, you see many different things. So many different branches, and each branch has so many different small branches and smaller branches and twigs and leaves and so many other things, fruits and flowers and so many birds and squirrels and bees, butterflies living in the tree, fruits, everything, all separate, different. Every leaf says to the next leaf, I am separate from you. Every leaf can say that onto the next leaf in the same twig. That's how it is at the material, physical level. That's what we see, the world. We see the world of multiplicity and diversity. Everything is different. Everything is different in every way. But if you go down to the ground level, stand near the tree, then you see only one trunk. At the trunk level, tree is one. At the top level, tree has multiplicity, multiple objects, multiple things. That is how creation is. In this creation, we are all, each one of us is a separate being, including animals, plants, and inanimate objects, all of nature, sun, moon, stars, and galaxies, everything, all different. But if you converge and go deeper and deeper in, and inquire into the nature of our inner personality, we find that we all converge and become one, spiritually, one divinity pervading all beings. Now, that is the illustration. What is the implication of this one? Implication is far-reaching. Whenever we see somebody or something, even in inanimate objects, we should remember that the same divinity is present in me, is present in that person, in that object, in that animal, in that plant. And therefore, we should accord respect, compassion, and love. This is the basis for the golden rule, which we saw in the 6th chapter. That is the implication. Whenever you see somebody, remember God is present in that person. If you keep on doing this, what happens is amazing. Swami Turyananda said, whatever is our imagination today will become our experience tomorrow. If you imagine, purposefully imagine the presence of God, you don't have to say anything to the person. No conversation, no other discussion is not useful. In our minds, we see the divine presence in that person. Then what happens, if you keep on doing this, imagining this, that imagination turns into our experience later. This is what Swami Turyananda said. So whatever we think, that will become the reality. That is the implication. Every time we see somebody, we have to remember that God is present in that person or any other object, even in inanimate objects. So treat the inanimate objects gently. That is the implication. So how God is present in all the beings in different ways? That's going to be explained in the next several shlokas. How can we remember God's presence? Well, everything is different. A tree is different from a person. So how can one God be present in widely different beings? That is being explained by several examples in the next few shlokas. So let us see verse number 8. The same thing will come in chapter 10, Vibhuti Yoga. So let me do verse number 8. Rasoham apsu kaunteya prabhasmi shashi suryayo pranavas sarva vedeshu shabda khe paurusham drishu. In each being, different beings, God is present in different ways. We can recognize God is given how he is present in widely different things. Raso amapsu kaunteya. Apaha means water. The word water, apaha, in Sanskrit is always used in plural. Apsu, in water, aham, rasaha. Rasaha, aham, apsu. In water, I am the essence, life-sustaining essence. unless water is there, life cannot be sustained. Even without food, we can go for a long time. But without water, we cannot live long. Water is life, has life-sustaining essence in it. That is the presence of God. God is present in water as a life-sustaining essence. Rasaha means essence. The Tamil word rasam, you know, people are familiar with that. Same, essence. Rasam means essence. Essence of life-giving, life-sustaining essence is present in water. That is God's presence. God is present in water as the life-supporting essence. So we have to recognize. In different things, is present in different ways. We can recognize. Second one, Shashi Surya Yoho Prabha Asmi. Prabha means splendor, brightness, deepti. Shashi means moon. Surya means sun. In moon and sun, we see brightness. Different ways. In the sun, we see the blazing brightness, heat, energy. In moon, we see cool, soothing brightness. Both are indications of the presence of God in the sun and the moon. This will again come in the 15th chapter. There's a verse, verse number 12. If you like, you can make a note of it. Otherwise, you can wait until we go to 15th chapter. Verse number 12 in chapter 15, Bhagwan says exactly the same thing. He says, Yada ditya gatam tejaha jagad bhasayate khilam yachandramasi yacha agnau tattejo vidhi mamakam. He adds fire also there. Aditya gatam tejaha. Aditya means sun. Teja means splendor, brightness. The brightness in the sun, yachandramasi. Chandrama means moon. Moon also has brightness, cool, soothing brightness. Yacha agnau, fire also has brightness, very hot. Without warmth, we cannot live. Warmth is necessary for life. So God is present in all these things in nature. These are some examples. Everything cannot be listed because infinite things are there. Give some example, illustrations. Yacha, Shashi Surya Yoho Prabha Asmi. Asmi means I am present as the brightness in moon and sun. That's how we recognize God's presence in sun and the moon. Actually, the sun and moon play a very important part in the life of people. We don't pay attention because we see everything, every day in the sky. We take them for granted, their presence for granted. But everywhere that is not available. If you go to further planets, even in our solar system, like Neptune, Pluto, Uranus, there is no sunlight. The sunlight is there, but very faint, not enough to sustain life. There is no water. There is no moon. Moonlight is there, but it is faint. So only on the earth, the special conditions exist to support life, all forms of life. So that is the presence of God. So whenever we see sun or moon, we should remember God is present in the sun and moon as the brightness. Then, Sarva Vedeshu Pranavaha. Pranava means the Omkara. Omkara is the most important sound in all the Vedas, Sarva Vedeshu. So many mantras are there. Hymns are there. But of all of them, Om is the most important sound in all the Vedas. So God, Om represents presence of God. All forms of God, with form, without form, with attribute, without attribute. Om. By simply chanting Om, one can realize God. Om is in itself a complete mantra. It is almost always used in conjunction with some other mantra. Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namo Ramachandraya, Om Namo Narayana, like that. Om is always used at the beginning of every mantra. But Om in itself is complete. In itself. Sarva Vedeshu Pranavaha. Pranava means Om. Ke Shabdaha. Kam means Akasha. Space. Kam, ke means in space. Shabdaha, sound. Sound travels in space. that is the essence of the importance of space, is that it conveys sound. Otherwise, we can't hear anything. That is the presence of God in the sound, in the sky, in space. Drishu Paurusham. Dru or Nara means a human being. Male or female, doesn't matter. In human beings, Paurusham, that means strength. Drishu Paurusham. It says in the translation, manhood in men. That is it's a partial view. There is Paurusham, probably more Paurusham in women than men, but they don't display that way. Men are macho. Oh, I can do this, I am strong. But women have quiet strength. In a very stupendous amount of strength is hidden in women. In their ability to forbear, that strength is there. So it's all human beings, Paurusham, Drishu. That is how we recognize the presence of God in different things. Then more examples are given in the subsequent verses. Verse number 9. Punyo ganta prithivyam cha tejas chasmi vibhavasau jivanam sarva bhuteshu tapas chasmi tapasvishu. Very nice verse. Prithivyam, prithivi means the earth. What is the special feature in earth? Prithivyam punyah gandaha, a divine, very pleasant smell. When earth is being dug, you can feel the special smell. When the grass is being mowed, fresh grass, you can feel the special smell. Very pleasant kind of smell, life-sustaining. And prithivi supports the whole life. Everything in our life from birth to death and before birth and after death happens on the earth. So every morning when we get up from bed, wake up and get up from bed, we should say a prayer to Mother Earth. Oh Mother Earth, I have to keep my feet on you. There's no other way. Please forgive my touching you with my feet. So that sloka has to be chanted every morning before we place our feet when we wake up from sleep and stand up on the floor. The sloka is Samudra Vasane Devi Parvatastana Mandale Vishnu Patni Namastubhyam Padasparsham Kshamasvame. Vishnu Patni, Mother Earth is the divine mother, Vishnu's consort. Namastubhyam, I bow down to you. Vishnu Patni Namastubhyam Parvatastana Mandale, the huge mountains, Meru Mountain, Himalaya Mountain, they are like her chest, her bosom. Padasparsham Kshamasvame. Padasparsham might have to touching you with my feet. There's no other way. You have to stand on the earth. Where else can you keep our feet? Kshamasva, please forgive. Vishnu Padya Namastabhyam Padasparsham Kshamasvame. Please forgive. Like that prayer we have to say and then keep our feet on the Mother Earth. The essence of Mother Earth is Punya Gandaha, the fragrant smell of fresh earth. Then next one is Vibhavasau Tejaha Cha Asmi. Tejas Cha Asmi has three words in it. Tejaha Cha Asmi. Teja means deepti, splendor. Vibhavasau in fire, warmth, heat. Without heat, the body cannot be sustained. Animals, plants, people, all we need warmth. Vibhavasau in fire. Vibhavasau means fire. In fire, I am the warmth. I am the heat. That's how God is present in heat. In different things, He is present in different ways. But He is the same divinity. That's how we have to recognize in everything God's presence. Jivanam sarva bhuteshu. Life in all the living beings. Without life, there is no living being. Just matter. But what makes a being living being is presence of life. And that life principle in every being is the presence of God. Tapaschasmi tapasvishu. Tapasvi means ascetic, who does intense austerities. In the earlier days, Sri Ramakrishna explains in the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, earlier days, the seekers, serious seekers of God, they would live in forest hermitages. And every morning they would wake up early in the morning at sunrise and go into the deep forest and sit down under a tree and meditate all day until sunset. They don't worry about food and what I'm going to eat and no such concern about the body or food or anything. At sunset, they will go back to the hermitage, eat some fruits, whatever roots available in the forest, then catch some sleep. So that is tapas, intense austerity. That kind of ability to do intense austerity is due to God's presence in the tapasvis. Tapasvi is an ascetic person. I am the austerity in the ascetics. God is present in them in that form. Then we go to verse number 10. Bijam mam sarva bhutanam viddhi partha sanatanam buddhir buddhimatam asmi tejas tejasvinamaham. Sarva bhutanam mam bijam viddhi. Viddhi, word viddhi has come before. Viddhi means what? Know, understand, know that. Sarvabhutanam bijam. Of all the beings, I am the seed. Bija means seed. I am the seed of all the beings. Sarvabhutanam mam bijam vidhi. Sanatanam bijam, eternal. Eternal cause. Bija means the cause or source. So he says, know me, Arjuna, to be the eternal seed power of all beings. Everything originates from God. Everything is sustained by God when they live. Everything goes back and merges into God. That we have seen before. It comes in the Upanishad. It comes in the Gita also, several places. I am the origin. I am the sustainer. I am the destination. Everything comes back and merges into me at the end of their existence. There is a famous sentence in the Taittiriya Upanishad, which is often quoted. It says, yato va imani bhutani jayante yena jatani jivanti yat prayanti abhisammishanti tad brahma tad vijignasasva. The father says to the son, father is the teacher, son is a student. That used to be the system, custom in the earlier days. So the father says to the son asks father about Brahman. Father, teach me about Brahman, son says. This is what the father says in response. Yataha imani bhutani jayante. All these beings, whatever beings you see, people, animals, plants, things, nature, that from whom all the beings have originated, emanated. Yataha sarvani ivani bhutani jayante. Jayante, they have originated from that one divinity, which you call Brahman in the Upanishads. Brahman or Atman. Yena jatani jivanti. Yena means by whom, by whose power all the beings live. Without God's power being in us, we can't exist. It is God's power that makes it possible for us to do everything. It's present in all. Yena jatani jivanti yat prayanti abhisammishanti. At the end of their existence, everybody exists for a finite duration of time. Something, small animals live for a short time, birds in a small, not in a long period of time, not many years, but some beings live for a long time, like crocodiles and all those, they have very long life. Some trees live for hundreds of years. So after however many years they live, each being has a finite lifespan. One day their existence will end. Then what happens to them? they go and merge back into Brahman from where they had originally come. Yet prayanti abhisammishanti tad brahma, that is Brahman. Tad vijignyasasva, vijignyasa means inquiry into the nature of that reality. What is that reality? That reality present in all of us is that from which you all have come. Everybody, including your sons to our moons, have come from the same divinity. Everything is sustained by that divine power in us. Everything goes back and merges into the same source from where they came at the end of their cycle of existence. That is Brahman. Here it says, Bijamam Sarabhutanam. I am the source, seed of everything. From me, everything comes. And into me, everything goes back. Then next line, verse number 10. Buddhir buddhimatam asmi. Buddhiman means a very intelligent person who has very sharp intellect. Of such people who have very sharp intellect, very highly intelligent people, buddhihi asmi, I am the intelligence. What makes an intelligent person special? It is the intelligence. We all have intelligence. Animals also have, but to a very limited extent. People have more. Among people, some have very high, very sharp intellect. Some are medium, some are dull. But whatever intellect is there in all the beings, it is his presence. God is present in all the beings, among the intelligent beings, as the intellect. That's how we recognize God, in presence of God. Tejas Tejasvi Namaham. Tejasvi means a very bright person. It says here, I mean, of those who are splendorous, I am the splendor. Some people are very bright, very sharp, very bright, very intelligent. That power in those people is the presence of God. That's how we recognize the presence of God. Then next shloka, verse number 11, very interesting shloka, worth paying attention to. Verse number 7-11, that's how I remember, 7-11. Balam balavatam asmi kamaraga vivarjitam dharma viruddho bhuteshu kamosmi bharatarshabha. Balavatam balam asmi. Some very strong people are there, like Bhima. Bhima and Hanuman, power, the symbol of strength. In the old traditional gymnasiums, not the modern one. Modern ones are all equipment and electronic and machines and everything. Old style, where the wrestlers used to go and train. There they used to keep the picture of Hanuman in a very old gymnasium. Because Hanuman is the presiding deity of wrestlers. He gives the strength. Hanuman gives the strength. That strength in strong people is the presence of God. There's a story Sri Ramakrishna narrates in the gospel. There was a wrestler. His name was Hanuman Singh. You must have read that in the gospel. And he was known to be a very powerful, skilled wrestler. Old style wrestling. Then another wrestler came to challenge him. A Muslim wrestler came. So a date was fixed for the wrestling match between Hanuman Singh and the visiting Muslim wrestler challenging him. So the Muslim wrestler went on eating a lot of food. Lot of butter and meat and whatever he went on eating to become strong for the wrestling event. Hanuman Singh ate very little of food and then constantly prayed to Hanuman for strength. On the day of the wrestling match, Hanuman Singh did not eat any food, spent all the time in prayer. Then they both met in the wrestling arena. Everybody thought this Hanuman Singh is going to lose. He has not eaten anything, he has been fasting. How can he win? That Muslim wrestler is a very big, strong, stout fellow, he will defeat him easily. But what happened was, in the wrestling match, Hanuman Singh easily defeated that Muslim wrestler. Sri Ramakrishna tells the story in the gospel. So Hanuman gives the strength. That strength in strong people, balam balavatamasmi, is the presence of God, indicates the presence. God is present in strong people as their strength, in intelligent people as their intelligence, in tapasvis as the tapas. Is present in everything. This is how we have to recognize God's presence. And we are all connected. Sutre Manigana Iva, verse number 7, chapter 7, verse number 7, 7, 7. We are all connected by one common thread. We are all beads in a necklace, connected by one common thread running through all of us. That's the divine presence in all of us. How to recognize? This is how to recognize. He gives examples. Balam balavatam asmi. That bala should not be a brute strength. It should be free from kama and raga, lust and attachment. If the strength is there, if it is not accompanied by detachment, compassion, then the brute strength, it can be very destructive. A person who has no thinking power but a lot of strength, he can destroy everything. But that bala has to be sattvic strength. Sattvic strength is kama raga vivarjitam, free from kama and raga. Kama means lust, desire for unreasonable, uncontrolled desire. Raga means attachment. These two should not be there. That kind of pure sattvic strength is true strength. I gave the example of this. I told the story of Vishwamitra and Vasishtha. Vishwamitra had a army, physical force. He was a king. That is rajasic strength. Vasishtha had his tapobala. Tapobala means the spiritual strength obtained by tapas, long austerity. Eventually, Vasishtha's tapobala, spiritual strength, proved to be far superior to Vishwamitra's this army strength, physical rajasic strength. Balam balavatam asmi kamuraga vivarjitam. Then next line, dharma viruddho bhuteshu kamosmi bharatarshabha. Oh Arjuna, bharatarshabha. Rishabha means a bull. Among all the bharatas, Arjuna is like a bull, strong person, courageous person. Bhuteshu, among all the beings, kamasmi, I am the desire, but what kind of desire? Dharma aviruddha kama. Virodha means opposite, against something. Aviruddha means not opposed to, in conformity with. Dharma, dharma aviruddha kamasmi, I am the kama desire, but desire which is not opposed to dharma, dharmic desire. There are all kinds of desires in our minds. Not all of them are good, but there are certain desires which are good, which take us forward in our spiritual life. The desire to have more devotion to God, the desire to help other people, the desire to have holy company, these are all sattvic, dharmic desires. They are good. Those desires are good. They help us to move forward in our spiritual life. But bad desires, I don't give you an example of bad desires. We all know bad desires, which are opposed to dharma, they are destructive. We should curb them, control them. Dharma viruddho bhuteshu kamosmi bharatarshabha. Okay. Now we come to another verse. Verse number 12. Ye chaiva sattvika bhava rajasastamasaschaye matta eveti tan vidhi natvaham teshu te mayi. This is a very interesting verse. My throat becomes dry when I'm speaking. Bhava, you see the word bhava in the middle of the first line? Bhava means any object. Abstract, concrete, whatever, living now. Non-living. All those are in chapter 17, 18 chapters. Three gunas are there in all of us. Actually, it came in the second chapter. Traigunya Vishaya, I think it's verse number 45 in chapter 2. Traigunya Vishaya Veda Nishtray Gunyo Bhavarjuna. All the objects described in the Vedas consist of three gunas, Sattvic, Rajasic, Tamasic. So all those objects which are constituted of Rajasa, Sattvika, Tamasa, all of those, that means everything in nature, Matta Eva, from me, Tan Viddhi. Viddhi means understand, as it came before in the 10th verse. Viddhi means understand. Know that they're all from me. Matta means from me. They're all the objects, whether they are Sattvic, Rajasic, Tamasic, or any combination of those three, are all originated from me. That idea has come before. Everything originates. I am the seed of everything. It will come again in the Gita. Matta eva iti viddhi tan viddhi. Know them to be from me alone. He is this body source of everything. Nat tattvaham teshu. I am not contained in them. I am not under their control. Commenting on this phrase, natvaham teshu, natu aham teshu. I am not in them. That means what? Aham teshu tadadhinaha. I am in charge of them. I control them. They are not in. They are in my control, but I am not in their control. Te mai. Natvaham teshu. I am not contained in them. I am not controlled by them. On the other hand, te mai. They are all present in me. He is the Lord, and we are the created beings. He controls everything. So he is the chief of everything, source of power of everything. I'm not under their control or sway. They are under my control. Now we go to verse number 13. Tribhir gunamayair bhavai ebhis sarvamidam jagat मोहितं नाभिजानाति मामेभ्यः परमव्ययम्. Here Bhagavan Sri Krishna describes the majority of people. I can say majority of people because as we saw in the 7th chapter, verse number 3, in the same chapter, verse number 3, one out of thousands even tries to know God. Most other people are satisfied with worldly life. So those are the majority of people. They are deluded. Mohitam. Idam sarvam jagat. Sarvam idam jagat. This whole world. Mohitam is deluded. By what? By the objects that they see around. They are fascinated by the creation. They are not concerned about the creator. So Ramakrishna gives the example of a rich person owning a very big bungalow, garden house, lot of property, and he has lot of other possessions, property, everything. When a person's home, such a big, very rich person's home, generally people are interested in the wealth that person has. How many garden houses he has, how much property he has, how much money he has. All these things people are interested, but they're not interested in knowing him. Same thing about God. We are in this world, we are fascinated by the creation. Everything is so interesting. I want to have this, I want to have that one, which is very interesting. But who created all these things, that we don't think about. We don't think about the creator, we are concerned, fascinated by the creation. That is what Krishna is saying here. Ebihi bhavaihi. Bhava means padartha, any object. So many objects are there. Sense objects are there in this universe. Everything is a sense object, including our own body. It's a sense object. You are fascinated by it. Tribihi gunamayahi. All sense objects are made up of the three gunas, sattva, rajas, and tamas. That we know. It will come again in much detail later. Idam sarvam jagat mohidam. Mohitam, this whole universe, that means majority of people. Majority of people are fascinated. Mohitam is fascinated, deluded. by the creation. So many interesting things are there. Travel, entertainment, property, possession, adventure, so many things are there. You are busy, you are fascinated. But who created this thing? He remains unseen, not visible. We are not worried about it. You know, very few people want to know God. Most people are interested in the creation of God. So many interesting things they want to pursue. Mohitam, Maam Param Avyayam Na Abhijanati. Second line. Abhijanati means majority of people. Idam Savam Jagat, this whole world does not know me. We don't know God, but we are familiar with everything in God's creation. We can tell everything about everything. There are some games like Jeopardy, etc., trivia. Those people know fantastic amount of data they keep in their mind. They can tell you who sang what song in the 1953 movie. Everything is in their minds, on their fingertips, on the tip of the tongue. But asking them about God, who created this? No. There is no question in Jeopardy about God. All questions are about the creation of God. Movies and geography and all entertainment and celebrities, everybody knows, those people know everything, every detail they can remember. But ask them about God, blank. That is what Sri Krishna is saying. This actually came in the third verse of the same seventh chapter. Manishyanam sahasresho kaschid yatati siddhaye. Of thousands of people, sahasresho manishyanam, of thousands of people, kaschid yatati siddhaye. One rare person tries for perfection, for liberation, to know God. Even of those few who try, only one rare person here and there succeeds in knowing God in reality. That is verse number 3 in the same chapter. This is what he is saying here. Idam sarvam jagat, this whole world, mohitam, is deluded by what? Tribir gunamayehi bhavayehi. By all the objects which are made up of the three gunas. But God is nistraigunya. Beyond the three gunas, that we are not interested. We are interested in the three gunas, objects made of three gunas. Who is me, Maam? Param Avyayam. I am the supreme. Param means supreme. Avyayam means imperishable. Imperishable means he is not subject to any kind of limitation. In the commentary, Shankaracharya says, describing Avyayam, Avyayam Vyayarahitam, Janmadi sarva bhava vikara varjitam ityartha. For God, there is no change. All beings go through six changes that we have seen before. Everything, including the sun, galaxies, we all go through, all the human beings, animals, and go through six changes. You remember the six changes? But God is the only thing that does not undergo any change, always the same. Pure consciousness cannot change in any way. Mohitam nabhijanati, mamebhya paramavyayam. Mam means me, Lord is Bhagavan is speaking. People don't try to understand me. They are fascinated by the fantastic variety of things that are available in the creation. Everything interesting, they are busy with that. So what is the message here? Message is we should turn our attention from the world towards God, which is within each one of us. That change we have to make. Avrita Chakshu Upanishad says, most people are fascinated by the world, but a rare seeker of God, of the self, turns his attention 180 degrees and turns his attention, focuses attention in the self within. Other people are looking outside. Oh, this is nice, this is interesting, this I want to have. We should not do that mistake. Then we go to verse number 40. Here, the power of Maya to delude us is being explained. Daivi yesha gunamayi mama maya duratyaya mamevaye prapadyante maya metam tarantite. Yesha gunamayi maya. This maya made up of the three gunas. Sattva, Rajas, Tamas. Daivi, this is divine Maya, the power of God. Maya is the power of God. My Devi, Esha means this. Esha, Gunamayi, Mama Maya, my Maya, the Lord is saying. Duratyaya is difficult to cross. It's not easy to escape the delusion created by Maya. Everything is so fascinating. Our attention is compelled. Our attention is drawn towards the world. This is interesting, that's interesting. Family, job, children, grandchildren, property, possession, entertainment, games, sports, politics, everything is interesting. That's how our time goes. Mama Maya, Duratyaya. Duratyaya means difficult to cross. Mamevaye prapadyante. Those people who take refuge in me alone. Mamevaye prapadyante. Those who take refuge in me alone. Prapatti means surrender to the will of God. Those who surrender to the will of God, we'll talk about surrender in a little bit. Those who surrender to me, mam prapadyante. Those who surrender to me, what happens to them? Te eta mayam taranti. They cross over the maya, ocean of maya. Other people get stuck in the web of maya almost permanently. There's a way out, but we are not looking for the way out. We are fascinated by the world. Now here, maya, you see in the first line, is described in other scriptures. Vivekachudamani, some of you have studied. Maya has two kinds of powers by which it deludes us. Maya deludes us in two ways. It has two powers. One is called avarana shakti. Avarana means covering something. Supposing there is a diamond jewel ornament here on this table. Now, if nothing is there, obstruction is there, I can see that one. But what happens is, somebody has kept a book or something on top of that. So what I am seeing is the book. I'm not seeing the diamond. Now, it doesn't stop there. On top of the book, they put an interesting doll, talking doll, moving doll. Now, more fascinating. So one is covering the diamond with a book, make it not possible to be seen. On top of that, something more interesting is projected. A dancing doll is kept on the book. So the doll is dancing and singing. Oh, we are fascinated. So interesting, so interesting. We forget about the time. We don't know there's a diamond in it. The doll is a small thing. Remove the doll, remove the book, and the diamond is there. That you are not able to do. You are fascinated by what we see through the senses, but we don't have the incisive vision or power to penetrate through the web of Maya, see the divine presence in everything. That we have to cultivate. So that is the power of Maya. Avarana Shakti, the power to cover something, cover the divine presence within us. Within the body mind, there is a divine presence. We are not able to see because covered by the body and the mind. And on top of that, whole world is projected, taking our attention outside, not on the self within. Vikshepa. Vikshepa means projection. Projecting something which is more fascinating, interesting, making us forget the divine presence within us. That we have to change. We should say, tell ourselves, all this world I am seeing, so much interesting, family, job, money, all this entertainment, everything, physical pleasures, they are only the projections. They are not the truth. They are hiding something. They are hiding the truth, which is God, which is present within me. I should stop looking outside in the world and start looking inside. Turn our attention 180 degrees. Avrita chakshuhu, amrutatvam icchan, desiring immortality. So that is what we have to do. That Maya power is being described here. How we delude human beings. Daivi, Hesha, Gunamaye. Gunamaye means made of the three gunas. Mama Maya, Hesha Maya, this power of Maya of mine. Duratyaya, difficult to cross. Ordinary people are so fascinated, drawn to the outside world, that they don't have the power to think deeply and try to see God within us. Ye mameva prapadyante, those who take refuge in me alone, prapatti means taking refuge, surrendering to God, surrendering to God. That will come in the 18th chapter, verse number 66. Those people, Eta mayam taranti, they cross over this maya. other people will continue to be deluded by the Maya and go through the cycle of birth and death and all those things in between. So what we have to do is we have to surrender to the will of God. Prapati is the key word in this shloka. Prapadyante. Now, Sri Ramakrishna gives two examples. How to do prapati, surrender. He says, a baby cat surrenders to the will of the mother cat. The mother cat puts the baby cat sometimes in the master's bedroom, under the master's bed, sometimes in the kitchen, a corner, sometimes in the closet. Wherever the mother cat puts, the baby cat stays there waiting for the mother to come and do something. If it is in pain, it will say meow, meow, it will cry. That is surrender to the will of the mother. We have to surrender the will of the divine mother. She is our mother. Another example he gives is, supposing a father and child are walking in a field. If the child holds on to the hand of the father, the child has to be responsible. If it leaves the hand, it may fall. Or if it leaves the father's hand, the child may fall. But if the father holds the child's hand, then the father will make sure the child is safe. So the child has nothing to worry. So we have to let God hold our hand and lead our lives. We should entrust our life to the will of God. And we should not try to take power and I will control my own life. We should not say that the monkey, baby monkey does. Baby monkey holds on to the mother monkey's body. So it has to be responsible. If it leaves, it will drop from the tree. But baby cat surrenders to the will of the mother. Like we should be like the baby cat. We should be like the child which will let the father hold its hand. Then father will keep it safe. You don't have to worry. That is prapatti. Mame vaye prabhadyante. Those who take refuge in me alone, surrender to me alone, te eta mayam taranti. They will cross over this ocean of maya and reach me. That is the message here. So we have to practice surrender to the will of God. Let our life be led by God. A devotee does not have any concern about what happens to him or her. That we'll study later in the ninth chapter. Ninth chapter, there's a verse number 22. When you go to that, we'll study there. Bhagavan Sri Krishna has said, those who are devoted to me, I shall take care of all their needs. Very famous verse 9:22, where God has promised that he will take care of all our needs if you are devoted to him. Constantly think about him. Ananyas chintayanto mam yejana paryupasate tesham nitya biyuktanam yoga kshemam vahamyaham. Very famous verse. We'll study that when you go to 9th chapter. There Bhagavan says, ye mam ananyas chintayanta, those who steadfastly, constantly think about me, worship me, are devoted to me, mame ananyas tesham nityabhiyuktanam, of those people who are always steadfastly devoted to me, what I shall do to them? Yoga kshemam vahamyaham. I'll provide whatever they need, and I shall protect what they have, whatever they have. Yoga means providing something that is absent, that is needed. Food and clothing and a roof over our heads and basic needs. That God will provide. That is yoga, provision of things which are needed, which are not present. That he will do. Yokshema means protecting what we have, what needs to be protected. Both he will take care of. So when he has promised, God has promised very clearly, then why we should worry? We should entrust our life to the will of God and be happy and free taking this name all the time. That is the message. We shall stop here today. And if you have any questions, we have a few minutes. Everything is so clear. No questions are there today.
Hello, Swamiji. Swamiji Bachubhai. Yeah, I like to go back last Saturday. You have mentioned about five elements, and space, earth, vayu, agni, all those. Now, those five elements on its own, they belong to a stool state.
They belong to what state?
They belong to a gross state.
No, there are, they exist in two ways, subtle and gross.
Yes.
The five elements exist in a pure form, then they are called ten matras. Air is only air, space is only space, not mixed with anything. Water is only water, not mixed with anything. Pure, nascent state. That is one. That they are called ten matra. But they don't remain like that always. They combine with themselves and then become gross elements, sthula bhuta. From the gross elements are visible to the senses, everything is made up there. Everything is made up of the five gross elements. These sukshma bhutas, subtle elements, they are not visible. They are very pure and they just exist in a pure state, pristine state.
Yes.
So how they combine among themselves according to a certain formula called Panchikarana.
Yes.
The formula you don't have to know, but if you want to know, it's very simple. Half of each element is combined with 1/8 of the remaining four elements. Half of air combines with 1/8 of space, 1/8 of fire, 1/8 of bhumi, 1/8 of water.
Yes.
So 4 times 1/8 is half, and half itself then becomes one.
Yes.
So when the subtle elements combine themselves in this way, then they become gross elements. They grow from gross elements, everything is made. That process is of mixing subtle element becoming gross element is called Panchikaranam. Pancha means five. Five elements combine among themselves in a certain way. You don't have to know this one. It's not essential information. Know there are five elements and everything is made of it.
So, Swamiji, this is Shankar. You talked about the story earlier from Upanishad. Is it from Mundaka Upanishad or?
Which one?
The story of the father teaching the son about Brahma.
Taittiriya Upanishad.
Taittiriya Upanishad.
Okay. Bhrigu teaches his son Varuna.
Yeah.
No, Varuna teaches his son Bhrigu. Bhriguru Vaivarunihi Varunam Pitaram Upasasar. Varuna is the father. Bhrigu is the student, son.
Student. Okay.
So the son asks the father, what is Brahman? Can you please teach me about Brahman? Then father Varuna says, Brahman is that from which everything comes, by which everything is supported, and then to which everything goes back and merges at the end. That's Taittiriya Upanishad.
Taittiriya Upanishad.
I have a question here from the live audience.
Well, I'm slightly confused about the example of the baby kitten surrender to her mother.
I will repeat the question.
Practically speaking, it seems like in spiritual life, a lot of self-effort is required or self-control is required. So that is contrary to what the baby kitten is doing. Somehow it seems
No example. The question was, the example of baby kitten waiting for its mother to take care of it can also be interpreted as not having to do anything, no self-effort. God will take care of your thing, he will not do anything. That's not how it should be interpreted. No example is perfect. We have to do self-effort. That came in the 6th chapter, sloka number 5. Every seeker must do 100% self-effort in spiritual life. Rest of it we leave to God. Whatever he provides, with that I'll be happy, satisfied, but I'm going to remember God all the time. I'll do my spiritual practice. Our duties, daily duties, if you have a job, you have to go to work every day. You cannot say God will take care of me, I will stay home. That won't work. We have to do our self-effort. Whatever responsibility we have, that we have taken, we have to fulfill that one. Then the result we leave to God. What happens after that, good or bad, success, failure, that is in His hands. We should surrender our the results of our effort to God, but you have to put in your self effort. Verse number 5, chapter 6. Uddhare dātmanātmānam nātmānam avasādayet ātmaiva yātmano bandhu ātmaiva ripurātmanaha. Self-efforted, self-surrender does not mean abandoning self-effort. We have to do putting our effort.
Swamiji, can I add something to Bachu Uncle's?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, with regards to the five tattvas that Pachu Uncle was saying, in our religious practices, when you get mantra diksha, any mantra diksha, they do karanyasam, anganyasam, and in that part of that is lam prithivyatmane gandham kalpayami. That means earth is relevant to smell. So gandham, like chandanam or sandalwood, they say that is how you give. Ham akashatmane pushpam samarpayami. That means through akash, this is all meditation. You don't have to actually give. You imagine akasham as a form of a flower. Like that for all five, like yam vayvatme dupam samarpayam. That means agarbati that you give through air. Air element is considered like that. Ram agniyatme deepam darshiyami. So you say the mantram and that is enough to, that is equivalent to some, to giving deepam. And then vam amrutatme amritam nivediyami. Instead of making elaborate prasadam, you just offer it mentally like that. And then sam sarvatmane samastopacharam samarpayami. So this is what they teach when they give you mantra diksha, any mantram, karanyasam, anganyasam. You meditate with those five elements and you offer. So I just wanted to add on to the question that Uncle was asking. So thank you.
Manati puja, that means mentally you offer all the five elements. Actually, when we do arati, evening arati in the Ramakrishna Math temples, we wave five things. First, we wave the a lamp. Lamp indicates life. Or fire or light. Tejas. Then we wave a shankha containing water. Water is the second element. Akasha. Tejas and then Agni and then water. After water in shankha, we wave a handkerchief. Handkerchief indicates space. The handkerchief is made of cloth. Cloth is made up of thread, horizontal, vertical strands of thread, warp and woof. There is a space in between everything. So that indicates space. And then after we offer a flower, we have a flower. Flower means a matter, smell. And then lastly, we have chamaram, indicating air. So all the five elements are offered during the evening arati. But some places only lamp is offered for simplicity. So all the five elements are offered.
Swamiji, please elaborate on the two powers of Maya. Avarana Shakti and Vikshepa
Shakti. Avarana Shakti means God is present in each one of us. That we know from our study. Vedanta says God is present within you. Now that His presence is covered. Avarana means covered. That we are not able to see God's presence. Covered by what? By our mind and body. That is our covering. Then on top of that, whole world is projected, drawing our attention outside. We don't think about the presence of God because it is hidden from us. So just like the piece of diamond, an ornament, something made of diamond is present here on the table. It is covered by a sheet of paper or a cloth or a book, something. So it is hidden. Not only that, on top of that, something more interesting is projected. Drawing our attention outside to the interesting object, but not allowing us to see the diamond hidden between those. Avarana Vikshepa. Whole world is Vikshepa, projection. So many things interesting, attracting our attention. So we don't think about God that much or at all.
Mamiji, for five things what you offer for arati, please repeat back again. Lamp is for life. Water in shankha, that's water. Handkerchief.
Cloth represents space.
Flower is for matter.
And the flower represents prithivi.
Prithivi. Okay. And
solid matter. Uh-huh. And chamara represents air.
Okay. Thank you.
Good.
Swamiji, I have a question about the sloka number 12. It's not very clear to me.
But Swamiji, before that, you keep missing on the second Shakti, Avarna Shakti, and the second we got cut off for that.
Vikshepa Shakti. Avarna Shakti. Vikshepa.
Vikshepa. Okay.
Vikshepa means projection. Projecting something which is not there. Diverting our attention from the real object.
Okay. Okay. Got because it. Thank you.
That's how the world is deluded by the world. How fascinating is this, that, and family life and money, good job, promotion, being CEO. So much vikshepa, so many things drawing our attention, so much interesting things. What about the Atman within? Forget about it, because covered by all these things. Vikshepa.
I see. Oh, got it. You did say, but we missed the word vikshepa.
Vikshepa.
Okay, got it.
V-I-K, vik. Shepa, S-H-E-P-A.
Yeah, got it. Thank you.
Shepa.
Hello, Swamiji. I still like to come back to five elements.
Hmm.
Those elements, how do they work in a causal state?
They exist in pure state, not combined with anything else.
Yeah.
And that is the sukshma bhuta. That comes from the divinity itself. In the Taittiriya Upanishad, there is a passage which says, from the Atman, all the five elements come out. Atmana akasha sambhutaha. Akasha comes. Space, a field is created. Akasha dvayuhu. When space is created, then air comes in. Vayo ragnihi. Then heat comes. Agni rapaha. Then water comes. Then prithvi. All the five elements emanate from Brahman, from Atman, and then they are in the pure state, then they combine among themselves, forming all the objects. That's the picture, one picture of creation. It's not the final. There are different views.
Yes.
But this is one view.
Thank you, Swamiji.
Very good.
Swamiji, I have 5, 12, 7, 7, 12. That's not very clear to me. It says, Sattva, Raja, Tama, all originates from him.
Yeah. Yes.
But they are not in him.
Yes. They are not, they don't affect him. They originate from him, but they don't, Sattva, Raja, Tama, they do not affect Atman. He remains free. Just like a snake has poison in it. That poison does not affect the snake. It's innate.
Somewhat like
that. No example is perfect, but somewhat like that. Gives an idea.
Okay, thank you.
Shall we close now with a closing prayer? Okay, closing prayer. Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinah Sarve Santu Niramayah Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu Ma Kaschid Dukkha Bhag Bhavet Om Shanti 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 Om. May all be happy. May all be free from diseases and other problems. May all realize and practice what is noble and dharmic. May no one be subject to any kind of suffering. Om peace. May there be peace and joy in our hearts. Adhyatmika Shanti. May there be peace and harmony amongst all the beings. No ill will, no hate.